Hello all. So in this section, let's start with the concepts of monoclonal antibodies. Now, what do we mean by monoclonal antibodies? Monoclonal means they are exactly same antibodies. And remember, one antibody binds to one antigen, they will have one target inside the cell. Okay, they will generally have one target inside the cell. That means they will bind to only one antigen. Okay, they will bind to only one antigen inside the cell. So they are exactly same. Clonal means they are exactly same monoclonal. Mono means same. Clonal means antibody structure. Now the point is, there will be certain exceptions. We have made now certain monoclonal antibodies which can bind to two targets as well. But this is the classical definition. Now remember how monoclonal antibodies, they are synthesized commercially. So the first question arises, how we commercially prepare these monoclonal antibodies. So commercial synthesis of monoclonal antibody is by a technique known as hybridoma technique. It is by a technique known as hybridoma technique. Okay, but nowadays certain newer techniques are also there, like gene amplification techniques. We increase the gene, okay, the expression of gene and more antibodies will be formed. Gene amplification. There is certain phage display by insertion of certain viruses. Okay, but what is important for you and expected from you is this hybridoma technique. So it is the most common technique by which we synthesize monoclonal antibodies, and the credit of inventing this technique, hybridoma technique, goes to two scientists known as Kohler and Milstein. So hybridoma technique was invented by two scientists, Kohler and Milstein, and because of this hybridoma technique, now we can synthesize monoclonal antibody, and these two scientists, they receive Nobel Prize for their invention of hybridoma technique. So by this technique, we synthesize monoclonal antibody. So let's discuss a little bit about hybridoma technique. So what we will be doing in hybridoma technique, there is a cancerous cell. There is a cancer known as multiple myeloma. Now remember that multiple myeloma is a cancer of plasma B cells. Okay, now plasma B cells, remember, they secrete antibodies. But now right now this multiple myeloma cell doesn't know against which antigen this multiple myeloma cell or cancerous cell should secrete antibody. So it does not know against which antigen it should function. Hence, we will provide the source of antigen to it. Okay, hence we will provide the source of antigen, and this antigen presenting cells, they are present in the spleen cells. They are present in spleen cells. So what we will be doing, we will be fusing these two cells. What we will be doing, we will cause a fusion of these two cells. We will fuse multiple myeloma cells with the spleen cells, and a hybrid will be formed. So how this cell will be fused? It will be fused with a chemical known as PEG, polyethylene glycol. This polyethylene glycol will fuse multiple myeloma cell, which will secrete antibody, with the spleen cells, which will provide an antigen. Now antigen is provided by spleen cell, antibodies is secreted by monoclonal multiple myeloma cell, and these cells, they will secrete only one type of antibody, which is known as monoclonal antibodies. Now these cells, they become immortal. They are cultured in a media. Okay, they are cultured in a media. That media name is, in which they will become immortal, that is known as heart media. Heart media stands for hypoxanthine, which will help in synthesis of DNA, replication of cells. Aminopterin will inhibit de novo synthesis of nucleotides, and thymidine, again a pyrimidine analog, which will help in DNA replication. So heart media. So just remember the name of this heart media, in which this multiple myeloma cells are cultured. They will become immortal, and they will secrete this monoclonal antibody lifelong against this antigen. Okay, so can we say that monoclonal antibody will have only one target or one antigen against which it will act? Now the second point is, what is the nomenclature of monoclonal antibody? Okay, let's talk about how we name these monoclonal antibody. Now, monoclonal antibody, let's write one example, then we will better understand. Suppose there is a monoclonal antibody known as cetuximab. Suppose this is an example known as cetuximab. So remember, all monoclonal antibody, they will end with the word suffix map. They will end with a suffix, which is also known as stem. Stem means the last word, known as MAB. This MAB word denotes, it stands for monoclonal antibody. MAB stands for monoclonal antibody. Okay? Antibody. So all monoclonal antibody, they will end with the word MAB, except one. The first monoclonal antibody which we synthesized does not end with the word MAB. That monoclonal antibody was Muromonab. So it is the only monoclonal antibody that does not end with the word MAB. It will rather end with the word NAB. Okay, so it's used for organ transplantation. So this is the last suffix. Now before this suffix, there is a word known as XI. Okay, so before this word suffix MAB, there will be an initial word. So this initial word XI, it tells us about the source from which we have synthesized this monoclonal antibody, source of origin. Okay, it will tell us about the source of origin. Now this source could be of different type. So the first word is MAB. So the first word is MAB, we know the last word is MAB. But before this MAB, there could be four words. Either it could be OMAB, O word will come. There could be ZMAB. There could be ZUMAP, or there could be just UMAP, Z word will not come. Okay, ZUMAP. Okay, so the word before MAP, it will tell us about the source of origin from where it is we are synthesizing. Now what do we mean by this word? If the word OMAP will come in any monoclonal antibody, remember the source is mouse. The source is, it is of mouse origin. Or you will write, it is 100% of mouse origin or some non-human origin. It is not a human variety. So it is of mouse origin. Let's write one example of this. Let's write one example. That is tocetuimab. So as you are seeing, OMAB word is coming. So it is a mouse origin. Now the point is why? So for this origin, you have to understand the structure of a monoclonal antibody. You know that an antibody has a Y-shaped structure. This is the heavy chain and there are two light chains. And this heavy chain part is this above part is known as Fab fragment, and this below part is known as FC portion. Okay, FC portion. And this Fab fragment is further divided into two. One is above outer portion known as variable region, which binds to an antigen, and the below portion is known as constant region or constant domain. Now what happens in OMAP, sir? This both FC portion as well as Fab portion is of mouse. So this monoclonal antibody, full of this whole, this monoclonal antibody is of mouse origin, 100%. Both FC and Fab portion is of mouse. Now the problem with this monoclonal antibody is that if you will inject in humans, it causes severe allergic reaction. The problem with mouse origin is it causes severe allergic reaction. Because if you are inserting the antigens of proteins of mouse in human, it will cause severe allergic reaction. So it could be dangerous. More than 70% cases, they will present with allergic reaction. So what we will try to do, now we have made XI. XI means chimeric. Now what we will do in this mouse origin, we will change this FC portion. We will change this FC portion into human form. Change this FC portion into human. And remain this, this Fab portion we will not touch, it will remain of mouse. So can we say XI word means chimeric? Chimeric means half human and half mouse. So the FAP portion will be of mouse or some non-human origin, and FC portion will be of human. So it is 50% human and 50% mouse origin. So it's a mixture. So these monoclonal antibody, they will end with the word ZMAP. So let's write one example. Example you can write as infliximab. Infliximab, XI word is coming. Okay. Similarly, we have written cetuximab. XI word is coming, so it will be also a chimeric monoclonal antibody. Now the third one you will be writing, the third one you will be writing is ZUMAP. Okay. Now ZUMAP, if word ZUMAP will come, it is humanized. And as only UMAB is coming, Z word is not coming, it is known as fully humanized. Okay. Now humanized means that 95% of this monoclonal antibody is of human. How? We will write. Now in this portion of humanized, we will convert this constant region of Fab also in human. We will convert this constant region of human also. So in humanized, remember, the human portion is of both FC portion and the constant region of Fab portion. The only non-human origin is Fab portion of variable region of Fab portion, that is of mouse. So most of the antibody will be of humanized. Let's write the example of this monoclonal antibody, that is trastuzumab, which is used in breast cancer. Trastuzumab, as you are seeing, ZU word is coming. And lastly, now we have made fully humanized, it is 100%. We have converted this, the variable portion also of human. So it is 100% humanized, 100% human. So it will have least allergic reaction. Let's try the example. The examples you can write is like adalimumab. Adalimumab used in rheumatoid arthritis. You are seeing U word is coming and MAB word is coming. So adalimumab will be a fully humanized monoclonal antibodies. Okay. So any word before MAB will tell us about the source of origin. Source of origin. Now before this word, there is having two words more to you. This word before the source of origin, it will tell us about the target system, the target or the disease against which this monoclonal antibody is used. It is used against which target or which disease it is used. And before that, there is a prefix. CU is a prefix. Prefix carry no special meaning. So the prefix, it has no meaning. Okay. Now, keeping this thing in mind, let's talk about the target or disease against which they are made. So if you talk about the target or disease against which they are made, we can write various examples. Like the first example, you can write that certain monoclonal antibody, they will have TU word in between. Okay. TU word in between, like cetuximab. We'll write TU word is coming. Let's write example cetuximab. Now TU word stands for tumor. So they are anti-tumor or anti-cancer monoclonal antibody. So if TU word will come, it will be an anti-cancer or anti-tumor monoclonal antibody. So cetuximab, TU word is coming. XI means chimeric, MAB means monoclonal antibody. I will tell you that this monoclonal antibody cetuximab has been approved for colorectal cancer and squamous cell carcinoma of head and neck, etc. So we will be discussing about various examples. In this section, we will discuss about various examples. Okay. Now the second origin you will be writing, that certain monoclonal antibody, they will have a word, LI word in between. Okay. Now LI means they will lower immunity. LI means they will lower immunity. Now where you want to lower the immunity? When the immunity is acting uselessly, like in cases of autoimmune conditions or in cases of hypersensitivity, because the immunity here is acting uselessly. Now remember, these monoclonal antibodies are also used as an anti-cancer monoclonal antibody because there is some defect in the immunity of our body. Okay. So let's write examples, certain example like omalizumab. Omalizumab, lowering the immunity, it has been approved for the treatment of one hypersensitive condition known as asthma. Okay. Similarly, ipilimumab is used in the treatment of malignant melanoma, a tumor, because the cancer, it has some defect. The immunity cannot kill the cancer, actually. There is some defective immunity in cancer patient. Similarly, we will have other examples, like if VI word is coming, VI means it is against a virus. Let's take an example like palivizumab. Palivizumab is a monoclonal antibody against for the treatment of RSV virus infection, that is respiratory syncytial virus infection. Similarly, if tox word is coming, that means it is against a toxin. Let's write an example like bezlotoxumab. So it is against a toxin. It is used against the toxin of Clostridium difficile bacteria. Okay, Clostridium difficile bacteria, which causes pseudomembranous colitis. Similarly, we will have OS. OS means it will be used for the treatment of osteoporosis. Okay, let's write one example, denosumab. So OS word is coming, fully humanized monoclonal antibody. It is used in the treatment of osteoporosis. Okay, so it will help to identify you. Similarly, if any word is coming, any means it is against neurons. It will be acting on neurons. Let's write one example, that is solanezumab. Solanezumab has been approved for the treatment of, any word is coming, humanized monoclonal antibody for the treatment of Alzheimer's disease. Okay, so we will be discussing, this is just a hint how to identify. So we will be discussing about various examples now. Okay, so let's talk about various examples of monoclonal antibody. Okay, so keeping this thing in mind, let's write the examples of now monoclonal antibody. Okay, so examples of monoclonal antibodies. Now, before writing examples, remember, all monoclonal antibodies, they are given by injections. What is the route of administration? Injection. They are not absorbed orally. All monoclonal antibody, they are given by injection. They are not absorbed orally. So keep this thing in mind. Let's write the examples of monoclonal antibodies. So the first point you will write, the monoclonal antibodies which are anti-tumor or anti-cancer monoclonal antibody, which are used in cancers. Okay, so let's write the names. So how do you approach this part? You will write the name of a monoclonal antibody. You'll write the target or the antigen it will block, because it will block only one target. And we will write the uses of those monoclonal antibody. Okay, so the first one, so any monoclonal antibody which is against a tumor, it will have a word, TU word in between. Okay, TU word will come in between. So let's write the first monoclonal antibody, that is trastuzumab. Okay, let's write the first monoclonal antibody, trastuzumab. Now this trastuzumab blocks which target? You'll write trastuzumab blocks one receptor on the cell known as HER, two, new receptor on the cell. It blocks HER2 new receptor. And where it is used? It is used in the treatment, and it is the drug of choice for HER2 new receptor positive breast cancer. Okay, it is used in HER2 new receptor positive breast cancer. Recently, it has been approved for HER2 new receptor positive gastric or stomach cancer as well. But what you have to remember, that trastuzumab is a monoclonal antibody which is the drug of choice for the treatment of HER2 new receptor breast cancer. Now let's understand this part. What do we mean by the HER2 new receptor? The full form of HER stands for human epidermal ह्यूमन एपिडर्मल ग्रोथ फैक्टर रिसेप्टर. ओके, नाउ व्हाई न्यू वर्ड इज कमिंग, बिकॉज इट वॉज आइडेंटिफाइड इन द न्यूरॉन्स ऑफ रोडेंट. इट वॉज आइडेंटिफाइड और डिस्कवर्ड ऑन द न्यूरॉन्स ऑफ रैबिट्स. नाउ दिस रिसेप्टर इज ऑल्सो नोन एज, दिस रिसेप्टर इज ऑल्सो नोन एज ई आर बी रिसेप्टर. ओके, ERB receptor. ERB words you don't have to remember actually the full form. Just for your reference, you have to write erythroblastosis retrovirus. Okay, so it was found there also. That is why we have name. Now the point is this receptor. Let's talk about this receptor. So this receptor is present on human cells. Let's say the cells of breast. So this HER2 new receptor is present on the cell. And when this receptor is stimulated, remember it causes cell division. And what happens in breast cancer, this receptor becomes defective and it continuously function. It continuously function and it will cause uncontrolled cell division, which can lead to breast cancer. So what trastuzumab will do, trastuzumab will come and it will inhibit this HER2 new receptor on the breast cancer. Hence it will inhibit rapid cell division in the treatment. Hence it is used in the treatment of breast cancer. That is why trastuzumab is also known as, it comes with a brand name. It comes with a brand name, a very famous brand name known as HER. HER means HER receptor. HER, SEPT. SEPT means receptor. IN means inhibitor. So HER receptor inhibitor. Okay. Now let's write the certain points with trastuzumab. What is the main side effect of trastuzumab? Remember, the main side effect of trastuzumab is cardiotoxicity. Okay, its main side effect is cardiotoxicity, and it has one advantage that it does not cause. There is no bone marrow suppression. Generally, anti-cancer drug, they cause bone marrow suppression. So trastuzumab spares bone marrow. No bone marrow suppression occurs. Now, what is the role of trastuzumab in breast cancer? What is the status? You will write the status of trastuzumab in breast cancer is, this trastuzumab, it is combined with one drug known as paclitaxel for the treatment of HER2 new positive breast cancer. Paclitaxel is also given in breast cancer. Okay. But remember, there is one more drug which has been approved for breast cancer, that is known as adriamycin. Another name of adriamycin is doxorubicin. Remember, trastuzumab should be combined with paclitaxel. While trastuzumab, remember, it should never be combined with adriamycin. Never combined with adriamycin, because the main side effect of adriamycin is also cardiotoxicity. So adriamycin also causes cardiotoxicity, and this cardiotoxicity of trastuzumab and adriamycin will become additive, okay, which can be very dangerous. Remember, normally trastuzumab causes cardiotoxicity in less than 5% of the individual, but if you are combining with doxorubicin, that cardiotoxicity will become more than 20%. Hence it should never be combined with adriamycin or doxorubicin. It should always be combined with paclitaxel for the treatment of breast cancer. Okay, so it's a very important drug. Just write a new drug now which has been approved. That new drug is pertuzumab. Now pertuzumab also blocks which receptor? HER2 new receptor, and it is also approved for the treatment of only breast cancer, not in gastric cancer right now. It has been approved for the treatment of breast cancer. So this is the first monoclonal antibody that is blocking HER2 new receptor. Now let's write the next class of monoclonal antibody. The next class of monoclonal antibody you will be writing is cetuximab. Again, a very important monoclonal antibody for you. Cetuximab. So shade it. Okay. Cetuximab blocks which antigen? Remember, it blocks EGFR receptor. Okay. EGFR. Now EGFR stands for epithelial growth factor receptor. It blocks epithelial growth factor receptor. Again, this receptor is present on cell, which is a type of growth factor which causes uncontrolled cell division. Now, this cetuximab, as XI word is coming, so it will be a chimeric monoclonal antibody. And it has become now the first line drug for the treatment of a cancer known as colorectal cancer. It has been approved for the treatment of colorectal cancer, metastatic variety. It is also an approved drug for squamous cell carcinoma. It has been approved for squamous cell carcinoma of head and neck. It has been approved for squamous cell carcinoma of lungs, which is also known as non-small cell lung cancer. Non-small cell lung cancer. So it has been approved there also. Okay, cetuximab. Now we have made certain new drugs of cetuximab, new congeners. You will write, the drug name is panitumumab. So it's a fully humanized monoclonal antibody, because umab word is coming. It also blocks EGFR receptor, and it is right now only approved in colorectal cancer. Okay, then you will write nesitumumab. It also blocks EGFR receptor, and it has been approved only in squamous cell carcinoma of lungs. Okay, it's approved only for squamous cell carcinoma of lungs. So they are specific drug for, but cetuximab is approved in all. So you have to remember the name of cetuximab. It's an important drug for you. Okay, let's write the next drug now, which will also have TU word in between. That will be rituximab. So let's write a drug, rituximab, a very important drug for you. Okay, rituximab. So the drugs which we are shading, you have to remember them. Now rituximab blocks CD20 receptor. Okay, it blocks CD20 receptor. Remember, CD20 receptor is present on B lymphocyte. It's a marker of B lymphocyte. Now it will inhibit the cell division of B lymphocyte. Because of this reason, it is used in the tumors of B lymphocytes, like non-Hodgkin's lymphoma and CLL, which we will be writing. It is used in the tumors of lymphocyte, and it is also given in cases of tumors of lymphocytic or lymphomas. It is used in lymphoma. It is also given in autoimmune disease, because when lymphocytes are acting uselessly, it will lead to autoimmune disease. So keeping this thing in mind, let's see the uses of cetuximab, rituximab. For mnemonic of uses, you will write a mnemonic, reliance. Okay, the mnemonic is reliance. Rituximab has been approved in one autoimmune condition known as rheumatoid arthritis. Okay, it is also approved for lupus erythematosus. In short form, it is also known as systemic lupus erythematosus, or SLE. It is also approved drug for idiopathic thrombocytopenic purpura, or ITP. It is also given in certain autoimmune disease like multiple sclerosis. Okay, it is used in two cancers known as non-Hodgkin's lymphoma . In non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, we use a treatment regimen known as R-CHOP regimen, that is known as rituximab, cyclophosphamide, hydroxydonorubicin, oncobin and prednisolone. So please refer cyclophosphamide for the treatment of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. And it is also used in CLL, that is chronic lymphocytic leukemia. In chronic lymphocytic leukemia, we use a regimen known as FCR regimen, that is fludarabine, cyclophosphamide and rituximab. So please refer fludarabine chapter for anti-cancer for the treatment of CLL. Okay, so these are the uses of rituximab. Okay, rituximab uses. Now, what is the main side effect of rituximab? Rituximab is given IV, And the most common side effect of rituximab is infusion reaction. So when you will give reaction injection of rituximab, it causes various infusion reaction like fever, chills, malaise, etc. And you know that rituximab is blocking the effect of lymphocyte, and lymphocyte provides immunity. So it will reduce immunity of the body, and reduction of immunity will increase the risk of infections. It will increase the risk of infections. Because of this reason, rituximab increases the risk of hepatitis B virus infection. It also increases the risk of JC, polyoma virus infection. So these viral infection risk has been increased seen by rituximab. Okay. Now let's talk about certain new modifications of rituximab, newer congeners of rituximab. Okay. So the first drug you will write obinutuzumab. Just for your reference, you will write ofatumumab. And lastly, efotuzumab. These monoclonal antibodies, they will also block CD20. And right now they have been approved only and only for CLL, that is chronic lymphocytic leukemia. So they are just like rituximab. Okay. Next, you will write there is a monoclonal antibody known as ocrelizumab. Ocrelizumab also blocks CD20, and it is an approved drug for multiple sclerosis. And it is the only drug we have in one variety of multiple sclerosis known as primary progressive MS. MS means multiple sclerosis. It is the only drug we have for the treatment of primary progressive multiple sclerosis, recently been approved, okay, in 2018. Now let's talk about other monoclonal antibodies which will have TU word. Okay, so the next monoclonal antibody you will write elmetuzumab. Elmetuzumab blocks CD52. Okay, CD52. It has also been approved for the treatment of CLL, and it has also been approved for the treatment of multiple sclerosis. Okay, multiple sclerosis, just like rituximab, but the target is different. Rituximab was blocking CD20, elmetuzumab blocks CD52. It has been approved recently in a cancer known as cutaneous T cell lymphoma. Okay, cutaneous T cell lymphoma. The next monoclonal antibody you will write is, okay, the next monoclonal antibody is blinatumomab. So as you're seeing, MO word is coming, so it is a mouse origin. So it's an exception. Remember, it blocks two antigen. One is CD3 and second is CD19. It blocks two antigen. It has two target because the two Fab portions are different. Now it has been approved in the treatment of refractory cases of ALL, acute lymphocytic leukemia. Okay, it has been approved. Let's move forward. Then you will write the next monoclonal antibody, that is dinutuximab. Again, TU word is coming. It blocks GD2 receptor. GD2 stands for ganglioside 2 receptor. Remember, ganglioside is present on neurons. It has been approved in the treatment of high risk or high grade of neuroblastomas, which is a very dangerous tumor in children. Okay, GD is ganglioside. Ganglioside is present on neurons. Okay, dino. So it is dinutuximab. It's U out here. Okay, the next one you will be writing is daratumumab and elotuzumab. Daratumumab blocks CD38 and elotuzumab blocks CD319. Okay, 319. They both are approved for the treatment of multiple myeloma. Okay, multiple myeloma. Next drug you will write is olaratumab. Olaratumab blocks platelet derived growth factor receptor. Platelet derived growth factor receptor alpha subunit. It has been approved for the treatment of soft tissue sarcomas. Okay, soft tissue sarcomas. Okay, so these are the monoclonal antibodies which are ending with the word TU. Okay, let's write certain monoclonal antibodies now, the second group, which will end with the word, which will end with the word LI. Sorry, they will have a word LI. LI means lower immunity. Lowering the immunity. And these two monoclonal antibody, remember, they are either used as an anti-cancer drug or they are used in hypersensitive condition or allergic reaction or autoimmune conditions when the immunity is acting uselessly. So let's write certain anti-monoclonal antibodies which are ending with the word LI and they are anti-cancer. Okay, monoclonal antibody, they are anti-cancer. So let's write the first name, that is ipilimumab. Sorry. So let's write the first name. That first name you will write is ipilimumab. Now ipilimumab, remember, it blocks. Ipilimumab. Ipilimumab, it blocks CTLA4 receptor. It blocks CTLA4 receptor and it has been approved for the treatment of malignant melanoma and it has been approved for the treatment of non-small cell lung cancer. Okay, malignant melanoma and non-small cell lung cancer. Now what is the CTLA4? Remember, on T lymphocyte, okay, these T lymphocytes are generally stimulated by antigen presenting cells, antigen presenting cell, and these lymphocytes, they will kill cancer. But remember, there is a receptor on antigen presenting cell known as CTLA4. If this CTLA4 receptor goes to T lymphocyte, remember, it inhibits T lymphocyte. And this T lymphocyte, it will inhibit, it's a receptor on antigen presenting cell which generally inhibit T lymphocyte. Hence, T lymphocyte will not able to kill. So it's an inhibitory receptor. So ipilimumab will block this CTLA4 receptor and T lymphocyte now will only be stimulated. They will not be inhibited by CTLA4. Hence, they will kill the cancer cells of malignant melanoma and non-small cell lung cancer. Okay, ipilimumab. Now let's try another drug, that is nivolumab and pembrolizumab. Nivolumab and pembrolizumab, they block one receptor known as PD-1 receptor. PD-1 stands for program death receptor. Okay, and where it has been approved? It has also been approved in the treatment of malignant melanoma and non-small cell lung cancer. Okay, now what happens when this T lymphocyte, let's move this story ahead, when this T lymphocytes, they become active, they go and kill cancer cell. They go and generally kill cancer cell. But remember, on the this cancer cells, these cancer cells, they form one ligand known as PD-L1 ligand. PD-L1 stands for programmed death receptor ligand. This receptor goes on T lymphocyte and T lymphocyte, it will act on PD-1 receptor. PD-1 stands for programmed death receptor and it will inhibit T lymphocyte. Because of this reason, T lymphocyte will not able to kill cancer cells. Hence, what we will be doing, nivolumab and pembrolizumab will block this receptor, hence this cancer will not able to inhibit T lymphocyte. Because of this reason, nivolumab and pembrolizumab, they will inhibit the inhibitory effect of cancer cells on lymphocyte, hence they will go and kill this cancer cells, because PD-1 receptor is generally inhibitory to T lymphocyte. So where they are used, remember, this combination of ipilimumab with nivolumab or pembrolizumab has been approved for malignant melanoma and non-small cell lung cancer, and it's a very good combination and the response is very good. Okay, now the next drug we have is the drug that will inhibit this programmed death receptor ligand 1. The drug is etizolimumab. We'll write durvalumab and avelumab. These monoclonal antibody, they inhibit programmed death receptor ligand, L stand for ligand, which is secreted by cancer cells. And where it has been approved? It has been approved for the treatment of, again you will write, non-small cell lung cancer. Okay, they're also approved in urothelial cancers like bladder cancers, etc. They have also been approved in thyroid cancer, especially anaplastic variety. Okay, so this is the next drug. Let's move further with other drugs now. Okay, so these are the monoclonal antibody which are ending with the word LI, and they are used in cancers. Now let's talk about other monoclonal antibodies which are used in autoimmune disease, autoimmune conditions. Okay, so the first monoclonal antibodies which are used in the treatment of asthma, autoimmune and hypersensitive conditions. So asthma, let's talk about first asthma, which is a hypersensitive condition. So monoclonal antibodies which are approved in asthma, we will just write the list. Complete details, you will just refer to the lectures of asthma. So the monoclonal antibodies in asthma are omalizumab. Omalizumab blocks, you'll write IgE. IgE is the monoclonal antibody that causes antigen-antibody reaction which leads to asthma, and it has been approved for the treatment of asthma, as well as it has been approved for the treatment of urticaria. So both are type 1 hypersensitivity. So how it is given? It is given by subcutaneous injection every 2 to 4 weeks, omalizumab. Let's write the next drug. The next drug you will write is mepolizumab. Mepolizumab blocks interleukin-5, which is the main interleukin which causes asthma. So it has been approved for the treatment of asthma, as well as it has been approved for the treatment of Churg-Strauss syndrome. Okay, Churg-Strauss syndrome. Next you will write Restlizumab. Restlizumab also blocks interleukin-5. It has been approved for the treatment of asthma. Then you write benralizumab. Benralizumab blocks interleukin-5 receptor, not interleukin-5 directly. Again, it has been approved for the treatment of asthma. For rest of the monoclonal antibody, please refer to asthma video. Okay, but what is expected from you, that you must remember these four monoclonal antibodies. So this is the level of expectation that you must remember. There are many other monoclonal antibodies also, but right now they are not very much used in asthma, but these four are commonly used. Okay, let's write certain other monoclonal antibodies. Okay, like monoclonal antibodies which are used in the treatment of one autoimmune condition known as rheumatoid arthritis. Okay, rheumatoid arthritis. The first group of monoclonal antibody you will write is IKH. I stand for infliximab. So XI word is coming. So it is a chimeric. Then you will write sertolizumab. As you are seeing ZU word is coming, it is humanized. And adalimumab, as you are seeing U word is coming, and golimumab, again a U word is coming, it is fully humanized. okay. And lastly, we have etanercept. Etanercept, in this etanercept, we have just removed the portion, FC portion. It is only the Fab fragment out there. Okay, so it is the just receptor portion. These monoclonal antibody, remember, they block TNF-alpha. They block TNF-alpha receptor, which is a very important. And TNF-alpha is the main marker which causes rheumatoid arthritis. So it has been approved for, you'll write, rheumatoid arthritis. It has also been approved for psoriatic arthritis. It has been approved for the treatment of inflammatory bowel disease like Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis. It has been approved for the treatment of Wegener's granulomatosis, and it has been approved for the treatment of sarcoidosis. So all granulomatous disease, we use these drugs. Now, how to give? Remember, this infliximab is the only monoclonal antibody which is given IV, intravenously. I for infliximab, I for IV. Rest, all other monoclonal antibody, they are given by subcutaneous injection. Okay, subcutaneous. But there is a point out here, what is the drawback? Remember, this TNF-alpha, it protects against certain infection. It can lead to reactivation of latent TB infection. Because TNF-alpha suppresses TB, it can lead to latent TB infection. Let's write the second group of monoclonal antibody which is used in cases of rheumatoid arthritis. You'll write, the drug name is tocilizumab and sarilumab. Tocilizumab and sarilumab, they block interleukin-6 and they are used in the treatment of rheumatoid arthritis. Okay? They are approved in the treatment of rheumatoid arthritis. There is one more monoclonal antibody, ciltuximab. Remember, ciltuximab also blocks interleukin-6, but it is not used in rheumatoid arthritis. It is rather used in a disease known as Castleman's disease. Okay, so just try to remember. So in rheumatoid arthritis, we use tocilizumab and sarilumab. Third, you will write. Okay, tocilizumab and sarilumab. So this monoclonal antibody is used in the treatment of rheumatoid arthritis. Now let's write certain other monoclonal antibodies. Okay, certain other monoclonal antibodies in other miscellaneous disease. Okay, so monoclonal antibodies in certain miscellaneous conditions. So the first monoclonal antibody you will write is ixekizumab. It blocks interleukin-17. Okay, interleukin-17. Similarly, we have secukinumab. It also blocks interleukin-17. And lastly, we have brodalumab. It also blocks interleukin-17. And these monoclonal antibodies, they are approved for the treatment of plaque psoriasis, a variety of psoriasis. Okay, psoriasis. The next monoclonal antibody you will write is ustekinumab. Ustekinumab blocks 2 interleukin. How to remember? Ki word is coming. Ki word is coming. Ki. Ki means interleukin. It blocks 2 interleukin. Interleukin 1, 2 and interleukin 2, 3. Okay. It has been approved for the treatment of plaque psoriasis. And it has also been approved for the treatment of Crohn's disease. So it has two uses. Okay. Crohn's disease. Now the next monoclonal antibody you will write is natalizumab and second you will write vedolizumab. Natalizumab and vedolizumab, they block integrin receptor. Now remember, integrin receptor are present on endothelial cells and that is why the WBC will come and attach to integrin receptor. And when they attach to integrin receptor, they can move out of the blood vessel through diapedesis or squeeze outside, and they will cause inflammation. They will cause destruction of tissue. So integrin receptor WBC binds, and which leads to inflammation. Now where these drugs are used, remember natalizumab and vedolizumab, they are approved in inflammatory bowel disease. Okay, there are two varieties of inflammatory bowel disease. One is Crohn's disease and second is ulcerative colitis. Okay, now there is a point out here that this natalizumab, this natalizumab also crossed blood-brain barrier. Hence, it has also been approved for the treatment of multiple sclerosis. So please refer the videos of multiple sclerosis for complete details. Natalizumab only, it has been approved, not vedolizumab. So among them, natalizumab has also been approved for multiple sclerosis, which is also an autoimmune condition. Let's move forward. Now other drugs, you'll write other miscellaneous monoclonal antibody, you'll write erinumab. Erinumab blocks CGRP protein, that is calcitonin gene related peptide. So this protein causes pain in cases of migraine. This monoclonal antibody has been approved for prophylaxis of migraine, recently been approved. Okay, sixth point, you will write eculizumab. Eculizumab blocks C5 complement, and it is the monoclonal antibody which has been approved for PNH, that is paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobin urea. Okay, paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobin urea. Seventh point, you will write solanezumab. Bepinezumab. As you are seeing, any word is coming, so it is against the neuron. These monoclonal antibody, they are approved for the treatment of Alzheimer's disease. Sorry, they are under clinical trial right now, but very soon they will get approved. They block beta 1 amyloid protein. Which gets attached, which get excessively deposited in cases of Alzheimer's disease. Next you will be writing is palivizumab, a very important monoclonal antibody. So shade it, because you have to remember it. So VI word is coming, so it is against RSV virus, respiratory syncytial virus, which causes one disease known as acute bronchiolitis obliterans. Okay, it causes acute bronchiolitis obliterans. Next you will be writing, that is raxibacumab. Okay, as you are seeing, backward is coming, it is against a bacteria known as anthrax bacteria. Okay, it is against anthrax bacteria, spores of anthrax bacteria. Then you will be writing, we have obelto saximab. As you are seeing, tox word is coming, it is against toxin of anthrax bacteria. Okay, similarly we will have bezlotoxumab. Again you are seeing tox word is coming, it is against the toxin of Clostridium difficile bacteria, which causes one disease known as pseudomembranous colitis. Okay, So this is the list of monoclonal antibody you must remember. For your information, you can write one more, that is Evolo, QMAB, and Eliro QMAB. So this is a very important monoclonal antibody you will learn in the chapter of hypolipidemics. Okay, so refer to the chapter of hypolipidemic. It blocks one receptor in liver known as PCSK9 receptor, and it reduces the level of cholesterol. It decreases the level of cholesterol by blocking this receptor. Hence, it is given in cases of familial, homozygous, hypercholesterolemia. Okay, it reduces cholesterol level in the liver. Okay, so please refer to the chapter of hypolipidemics for this. So this is the complete list of antibodies. Now we have made a special type of monoclonal antibodies. Those antibodies are known as armed monoclonal antibodies. Okay, now there is a special variety of monoclonal antibody known as armed monoclonal antibodies. Now what is do we mean by armed monoclonal antibodies? Suppose this is an antibody. With this antibody we have attached a toxin, okay, and this toxin will additionally kill cancer cells. Okay, so with this antibody we have attached, we have given an arm. Armed means we have provided one weapon to this monoclonal antibody. Hence they are known as armed monoclonal antibodies. Okay, so these monoclonal antibodies, they are only used in resistant cases of cancers because they are very dangerous monoclonal antibody. They are used in resistant cases of cancer. So this cancer, okay, this toxin will additionally kill the cancers. So let's write the names of armed monoclonal antibody. Okay, armed monoclonal antibody. So the first you will write is brentuximab, which is a monoclonal antibody attached to a toxin known as vedantin. It is attached to a toxin known as vedantin. Now what do we mean by this? So this brentuximab monoclonal antibody, remember, it blocks CD30 receptor present on lymphocyte. And this vedantin, remember, this vedantin is a microtubule inhibitor. It inhibits cell division by inhibiting microtubules. Okay, now where this brentuximab vedantin has been used, it has been approved for relapsed or refractory cases of Hodgkin's lymphoma, relapsed cases, and advanced cases of large cell lymphoma. So when the tumors are not treated by any other drug, then we use a very dangerous drug which is having a toxin with it. Okay, the next drug you will be writing is gemtuzumab ozogamycin. Now gemtuzumab is a monoclonal antibody that blocks CD33, and it is linked to a toxin known as ozogamycin, which is also known as calicheamycin. This toxin is also known as calicheamycin, and this calicheamycin, remember, it is a DNA breaker. It breaks DNA. Okay, so it will directly break DNA. It has been approved in the cases of relapsed cases of AML, which was not treated by other drugs, which was not responsive to other drugs. Third drug you will be writing is trastuzumab. So I hope you remember trastuzumab, the first monoclonal antibody we have discussed. Okay, and it has been attached to a toxin known as emtansine. So trastuzumab, remember, it blocks which receptor? HER2 new receptor. and it is attached to a toxin. That toxin is not M10, it is known as DM1 toxin. It is also a microtubule inhibitor. Where it has been used? It is used in resistant cases of breast cancer. It is approved in resistant cases of breast cancer. Now the next monoclonal antibody we have, they are linked to radioactive isotopes. And these radioactive isotopes will kill cancer cells. So that fourth drug you will be writing is Y90 Irbi Tumomab. Now Y stand for yttrium, and yttrium is a radioactive isotope. So this monoclonal antibody, you must remember, it's a very important for you because it is the only approved monoclonal antibody which is linked to a radioactive isotope. So this monoclonal antibody, it blocks CD20 and it is attached to a radioactive isotope. It has been approved for the treatment of relapsed non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Okay, so it is the only monoclonal antibodies which is approved and linked to a radioactive isotope. Before it, there was a monoclonal antibody which now has been banned. Okay, that was iodine 131 tocilizumab. It was also against CD20 and it was also approved for relapsed cases of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, but this radioactive, it has been banned. So the only drug we have is ibrutumomab. Okay, ibrutumomab. Now the last drug you can write, it is not a monoclonal antibody, that is an immunotoxin. It is not a monoclonal antibody, that is a immunotoxin. The drug name you can write is deni-leukin. Leukin means it will be some type of interleukin. Defitox. Okay, now what is deni-leukin defitox? Deni-leukin, as leukin word is coming, it is a type of recombinant interleukin. Okay, deni means it is interleukin 2, and this interleukin 2 is linked to a toxin known as diphtheria toxin. It is linked to a toxin known as diphtheria toxin. And this drug has been approved for the treatment of, it is not a monoclonal antibody, it is a recombinant interleukin 2 linked to a diphtheria toxin, and it has been approved for the treatment of cutaneous T cell lymphoma. Okay, so this is the complete list of anti-cancer drug that you must remember. Okay, so monoclonal antibody. So thank you very much. So now let's talk about certain monoclonal antibodies which are angiogenesis inhibitor. Remember, angiogenesis means formation of new blood vessels, so they will inhibit new blood vessel formation. Okay, now just remember that angiogenesis is a hallmark of cancer. It is a hallmark of cancer. So all cancers, they generally make new blood supply for them, only then they will able to survive. But angiogenesis inhibitor, they are also used in certain other condition as well. So let's write the names of the drugs which inhibit angiogenesis. The first drug you will write, the drug name is bevacizumab, a very important drug for you. So encircle this drug, you have to remember bevacizumab. It comes with various brand name like Avastin. Now what is the target of this drug? Bevacizumab, remember, it blocks VEGF. Okay, VEGF are, that is vascular endothelial growth factor receptor. Okay, so this growth factor receptor is responsible for angiogenesis. It causes angiogenesis. So bevacizumab blocks this receptor. Okay, it causes formation of vascular endothelium. Now it is, we know that angiogenesis is a hallmark of cancer. Because of this reason, if you talk about the uses of bevacizumab, bevacizumab is used in variety of cancers. That means it is used in various cancers, almost all cancers we can use it. So just write certain cancers in which bevacizumab has been approved. Bevacizumab has been approved as an add-on drug to colorectal cancer. Okay, colorectal cancer. It has been approved for other cancer as well, like you will be writing renal cell carcinoma. Okay, renal cell carcinoma. You'll write glioblastoma. Okay, cervical cancer, ovarian cancer. Okay, and non-small cell lung cancer. Non-small cell lung cancer. But what is expected from you is this colorectal cancer. Now, apart from this, bevacizumab has also been approved for one condition to inhibit angiogenesis in retina. Okay, because angiogenesis in retina is also known as neovascularization. When abnormal blood vessels formed in retina, they may rupture easily, which can lead to blindness. And neovascularization or angiogenesis occurs in retina in cases of diabetic retinopathy. Okay, diabetic retinopathy. It is also occurs in cases of age related macular degeneration. Okay, age-related macular degeneration. So bevacizumab has also been approved for this condition. Now remember, bevacizumab is given intravenously in the cancerous condition, and in eye condition it is given intravitreally, directly into vitreous humor. Okay, bevacizumab. Now what is the main side effect of bevacizumab? The main side effect of bevacizumab is hemorrhage and GIT ulcers, which can perforate also. Okay, hemorrhage and GIT ulcers. So it's a very important drug for you. Now let's write other drugs. Okay, let's write certain other drugs. The second drug you will write is Ramu, Kiri, sorry, Ramukirumab. Ramukirumab. Ramukirumab, it also blocks VE GFR receptor, but only second type. Bevacizumab blocks both type. It has also been approved for colorectal cancer. Okay, similarly gastric cancer and non-small cell lung cancer, just like bevacizumab. Okay, non-small cell lung cancer. Then you will write other drugs like elfibercept. Elfibercept, remember, it just contains receptor of VEGF. It is the receptor of VEGF. So it will block the circulating VEGF molecule, vascular endothelial growth factor. And it has also been approved in the treatment of colorectal cancer. It has been approved in the cases of, okay, it has been approved in the cases of colorectal cancer as well as age-related macular degeneration. Let's write the short form of age-related macular degeneration as ARMD. Okay, the fourth drug you will write is ranibizumab. Ranibizumab, it comes with the brand name Lucentis. It also blocks VEGFR receptor, just like bevacizumab, and it has also been approved for ARMD, that is age-related macular degeneration. So So these are the list of monoclonal antibodies which generally blocks VEGF, that vascular endothelial growth factor which causes angiogenesis. So these monoclonal antibodies are angiogenesis. Now the last type of monoclonal antibody, you will write monoclonal antibody in organ transplantation. Okay, monoclonal antibody in organ transplantation. So for complete concept of organ transplantation, please refer to the video. So the first monoclonal antibody you will write is basiliximab. Basiliximab, it blocks CD25 receptor. So it is antagonist at CD25 receptor. This CD25 receptor is a receptor of interleukin 2. So basiliximab blocks CD25 receptor, and it is given in cases of acute rejection of organ transplant. Okay, so organ transplant, when it is rejected, it is known as graft versus host disease. It is known as graft versus host disease. Second, you will write muromonab. Muromonab is the only monoclonal antibody that does not end with the word nab. It blocks CD3. Okay, it is also given in cases of organ transplantation. Okay, so these are the monoclonal antibodies which are given in cases of organ transplantation. Now just remember, there is a monoclonal antibody known as daclizumab. Daclizumab also blocks CD25, just like basiliximab. But this daclizumab has been approved not in organ transplantation, it is approved in multiple sclerosis, one autoimmune condition. Okay, so these are the various monoclonal antibodies list you must remember. So this basiliximab is a very important monoclonal antibody that you must remember. Okay, so thank you very much.